Okay, can you see my screen?
Yeah. And we hear you, it's okay, fine.
Yes, okay, so.
Yes, we can see.
Thank you. So I will give a short talk about two things. The Corput lemma, which is a classical result in harmonic analysis, and also Mittag-Leffler functions. And I will try to motivate this question. And this is a joint work with Berikbol, Torebek, who is now at Ghent University. So let me see. It goes back, van der Corput lemma is one of the central results in harmonic analysis. It goes back to a paper of van der Corput. In fact, it is this year, it is exactly 100 years from his paper was published in 1921, but it was submitted. If you look at the paper, the submission date is end of 2020. So indeed, it is 100 years. So he published this paper. There are several results which are now attributed to van der Corput. So the first lemma is the following: is an estimate for the integral, oscillatory integral, like I write here. So if you have derivative of phi is non-zero and phi is a real valued phase function, then it happens that this integral decays as lambda goes to infinity. So what is of interest here is lambda going to infinity, because for small lambda it is bounded. But it is a very important result, because we have that if you just estimate, if you bring the absolute value inside the integral, then you don't see any decay. But the factor here, exponential function, is oscillating. So there are a lot of cancellations going on. And it happens that if the oscillations become higher and higher as lambda goes to infinity, then cancellation happens. And it's important in many problems to estimate the decay of this integral. So this is the case when the first case is when phi prime is monotonic and derivative is non-zero. And second van der Corput lemma is when we have derivative of order k is non-zero. Here we don't have any monotonicity assumption. And in this case, if derivative of phi of order k is non-zero, then we have that the integral decays like lambda to the power minus one over k. And this lemma really has lots of different applications in harmonic analysis. I will not go over all these applications, but I can just measure, I can just mention it's related to sublevel type estimates. If you want to estimate the set where the function is small, then it follows from van der Corput lemma, for example, that the measure of the set is bounded by t to the power 1 over k. So you can see that it is, it also has applications in measure theory and then various questions when you have to estimate size of when the function is small, some degeneracy. There is a question, of course, what the constant c depends on. There have been many works. So does it depend on, it's not, it doesn't depend on lambda, but here in principle, it may depend on phi and psi. And of course, one wants to have some uniform estimates. And this is one question. And another question is that if you extend this to higher dimensions, whether it would be possible to get faster decay rates. And so 2012, I wrote a paper about this, establishing decay rate of order n and also independent of parameters. So here I put parameter. And so under some geometric conditions on phi, on the phase function, one has this decay rate. So if in particular, if stationary phase case is when we have non-degenerate phase, then we have decay rate of order minus n over 2. But here I will not speak about this paper. It is a rather old paper. Here I will speak about extensions of this result. And I will motivate how it is extended. So As I said here, I mentioned people working on the classical von der Corput lemma. But now we move on to Mittag-Leffler functions, which we already saw in previous talks. So here is a two-parameter Mittag-Leffler function depending on alpha beta. It is well known that it generalizes the exponential function. As we saw, if we put parameters 1 and 1, then we just get exponential function. We have the classical Mittag-Leffler function if beta is equal to 1. But here we can do a bit more general, so we consider two-parameter Mittag-Leffler function, and we extend the classical integral. So, in the stationary phase, in the von der Corput lemma, one has to estimate this integral as lambda goes to infinity, but we can extend it in two ways. And first, we worked so with Berikbol. These are both papers on archive. Just one was in February, the other one was in May. The second part, because so in the first part, we analyze extension alpha beta when we keep I lambda phi of x in the as a variable for the Mittag-Leffler function, and the second extension is when we put I to the power alpha. So in some sense, this is this had, if in the case when, if we recall that E11 is equal to the exponential function, so if alpha is equal to 1, then both of these expressions coincide. But if alpha is different from 1, then we have different expressions. And I will show why it is. It's not generalization for generalization. It is there are some problems in fractional derivatives where such integrals appear. I will show some examples. But it is a question which is of interest by itself. What about decay for such integrals? So here I just give some examples of different Mittag-Leffler functions. So what can we expect? This is of course all well known. So if E11 is the exponential function, as I said, if beta is equal to 1, we get a classical Mittag-Leffler function. If we have parameters 1/2, 1, then we have this kind of error function. If we start putting beta to be integer, keeping alpha to be 1, we get this remainder for the Taylor expansion for the exponential function. So we can put 2, 1 to 2, then we get, you see, we get this kind of cosine, hyperbolic sines and cosines. If you put higher beta, then we get remainders in the expansions for the hyperbolic sines and cosines. So these are mostly examples. So we will be interested here for alphas between 0 and 2, mostly. So then these are relevant examples for this case. So we will consider. So this is now. I will just present results from this first paper here. Here we consider alpha between 0 and 1, and we consider the extension, which is like this. So again, I say that we replace exponential function but by this two-parameter Mittag-Leffler function alpha beta. And we will have another type of result because this non-stationary phase principle, if phi is non-zero and psi vanishes on the boundary of the integral, then basically we can integrate by parts as many times as we want, and then we get decay of any order. But here it is somehow important if phi is zero or not. So here we have phi of x minus phi of a, because if in the case of exponential function, we have a nice property that if phi of a is non-zero, we can just take it out of the integral, and we can always assume that phi of a is zero. Here, general Mittag-Leffler functions do not have this property. So we have to differentiate between if I is equal, if I may vanish at some point or it doesn't vanish. If it doesn't vanish, we get better results, as you will see. So, and first I give just to motivate a little bit. So why this is just one example why to consider this function. So here is a time fractional Schrödinger equation where we have Caputo derivative here. So since we have Caputo derivative, we can just put the usual Cauchy problem, Cauchy data, and just by the Fourier transform method, we get a solution in this form. So so this is an example where we have E alpha 1 appearing. And in particular, so if we apply the results, so now I'm talking about one-dimensional case always, but if we apply the results, which I will present about von der Corput lemma, then we get the decay rate. So we see that in this case, the solution decays for large times. And if one is, this is so-called dispersive estimate, and then it leads to Strichert estimates, then one can deal with nonlinear equations. So, but it is not our topic here. So you see that this is a simple application of the results that I will show gives decay rate for large times. Now I just quickly present the results. So first we consider, so here we consider this result, this extension here, when we have Mittag-Leffler function, we consider alpha between 0 and 1. And then we have the following results. So we have done quite comprehensive analysis. So if phi is non-zero, then we don't need, so the phase function phi is non-zero, then we don't need much regularity. We get decay rate of this integral as 1 over lambda. If phi, so this is the difference. If phi is non-zero, then we get decay rate 1 over lambda. If phi may be equal to 0, but derivative is non-zero, like in the case of von der Corput, classical von der Corput lemma, then we get, we lose a little decay, we lose a little bit of decay, so we get log lambda over lambda. And finally, if we consider the case, so this is the cases when alpha is less, strictly less than 1, but in this case, alpha is equal to 1, then the decay rate depends on beta. So in the first two cases, it does not depend on beta, as you see, but in the last case, it depends on beta. And here, beta is bigger than 1, because if beta is equal to 1, then we get I11, which is the classical von der Corput result, so we don't need to look at this result. So we can, we have these restrictions. And so what is, I will not have time to give proofs, but I just give an idea. So here are several ingredients. One ingredient is a fractional Euler formula, which is some kind of extension of the usual Euler formula for the exponential function when we have e to the power something, complex number, we can write it as sine, as cosine plus I sine. So here we can do something similar. So we can write Mittag-Leffler function, two parameter of a purely imaginary variable as a purely imaginary argument as a sum of two, but you see the doubling of alpha. A doubling of alpha here, but then we have some good decay rate. For example, this result shows that if alpha is between 0 and 2, then we have the decay rate of Mittag-Leffler function. So these are ingredients which we can use to prove these decay rates. And if alpha is equal to beta, then we get some improvement. So if alpha is equal to beta, this is the case again. If alpha is equal to 1, this is the usual case of the exponential case. But if alpha is equal to beta, so we have, if derivative of phi is non-zero, we get 1 over lambda. If both phi and phi prime are non-zero, we get 1 over lambda squared. And so here we assume a bit more, if we assume C2, so here in these results, phi is C1. Regularity is very important, how much regularity, because if you try to apply to some problems, then the regularity of the phase function is crucial. So there is, it's important to see what happens with the lowest regularity, so C1 regularity, but here we need monotonic condition. If we have C2, then we get, similar results, but we have some loss somehow. If, for example, if phi prime is non-zero, we get log lambda divided by lambda squared, but if both are non-zero, then we get the same result as here, 1 over lambda squared. And here we have one more ingredient to use in the proof. in the case of alpha and equal to beta, and we saw this formula, I think, in the previous talk, that E alpha alpha is related to E alpha 1 by differentiation. So here we can additionally integrate by parts. So this is van der Corput first lemma. Van der Corput second lemma is when we have k's derivative non-zero. And here we have something similar to the classical van der Corput lemma. So we have 1 over lambda to the power 1 over k. But in general, for general alpha beta, we have a logarithmic loss of decay of its log lambda divided by lambda to the power 1 over k. But if alpha is equal to beta, then we recover the same rate as in the van der Corput lemma. And there is one more result, this non-stationary phase principle. So if phi is regular and psi vanishes, psi derivatives vanish at the boundaries of the interval alpha beta, and we subtract phi of a here in this form, then we get decay of any order for this integral. So this is these are results more or less about first type, but and these results are sharp. So so we have these decay rates, and in some cases, for some ranges of parameters, we can show the sharpness. So this is technical. Maybe there are, and we get sharpness, but also we get some explicit estimate for constants. So if, for example, alpha is between 0.5, beta bigger than 2 alpha, you see we have the decay rate like this. So we write here explicit formula for the constant, but it's basically 1 over lambda estimate from above. And we have, so we have also if phi and phi and psi are non-zero, then we have the same estimate from below, also 1 over lambda. So so it shows that the decay rate, at least for this range of parameters of alpha and beta, the decay rate of 1 over lambda is sharp. So if m1 is, if phi can be equal to 0, then in fact, we have lower bound, which is worse than that. So there are many open questions here. What about other values of parameters? Whether this decay estimate from below is sharp. So, but we don't know, but at least in some cases, we show that the obtained estimates are sharp. So this is the case when alpha is less than 1/2 and beta is equal to, beta is larger than 2 alpha. Basically, if beta is equal to 2 alpha, but here alpha is strictly less than 1/2, we have the same thing. So here is basically lambda cube divided by lambda fourth. So estimate from above that we get is 1 over lambda, and the same estimate from below is also 1 over lambda. So again, in this case, these estimates appear to be sharp with respect to the parameter lambda. Okay, and this can be viewed just as a curious application. We can think of this as generalized Riemann-Lebesgue lemma, because classical Riemann-Lebesgue lemma tells us that if function is in L1, then the Fourier transform decays as when the Fourier parameter goes to zero. So van der Corput lemma can be seen as a quantitative version of this. In the case when f is c1, then we get we get a bit more than the Riemann-Lebesgue lemma, which says that it goes to zero. Here we get 1 over k. And here we can think of this to be a fractional, this Mittag-Leffler version of Riemann-Lebesgue lemma, because if f is equal, if f is an L1, then this results imply that so this Mittag-Leffler Fourier transform goes to zero. But if we have more regularity C1, then we get different decay rates depending on parameter alpha. So this is a quantitative version of the Riemann-Lebesgue lemma in this setting. Okay, so now I will briefly talk about the second paper where we put, so here instead of this integral here, which I talked about before, we consider I to the power alpha. So again, as I said, as alpha is equal to 1, they coincide, but in general, they are not. And here we can consider alpha between 0 and 2 compared to between 0 and 1 in the first case. And here we have some, again, we have some extra ingredients for the estimates. We have, we can use also another estimate for Mittag-Leffler function, but two parameter Mittag-Leffler function, which is useful for this consideration. So here, again, I show an example. I show two examples when this kind of oscillatory integral appears. So time fractional Klein-Gordon equation with Riemann-Lebesgue. So we put Riemann-Lebesgue derivative here. In this case, we know we cannot pose Cauchy problem, but we can pose a modified Cauchy problem with Riemann-Lebesgue integral here. In this case, you see that the solution can be written explicitly. It is this I to the power alpha appears. So in the gain, we can estimate, we get this kind of, there is no decay, we don't get decay rate, but we get boundedness of solutions, of solution U for large times. In this case, and so this is time fractional Klein-Gordon, because we have here basically second derivative, and alpha is between 0, 1, and 2. So this is not like a heat equation, this is more like wave equation, and with a mass term. So this is Klein-Gordon. And the other case is time fractional Schrödinger equation, so alpha between 0 and 1. So we have like derivative of order less than one, but here we have I to the power alpha UXX. So this is can be viewed as some kind of Schrödinger type equation. So here is Caput derivative. So we can put Cauchy data. Again, we get explicit formula for solution. So here beta is different from alpha. I to the power alpha appears. So we are in the case of the second type of estimate, and we get the boundedness of solutions applying our results. And here I now briefly show you the results. So here is I now denote the second type, and we have I to the power alpha. And indeed we have, so if phi is non-zero, we have decay rate 1/λ when beta is large enough. If beta is smaller than alpha plus one, we get decay rate depending on both alpha and beta. And if alpha is two, so this case is alpha less than two, if alpha is two and beta is bigger than one, then we have this decay rate. And we don't exclude, we don't include the case, so we have to exclude some results, some ranges of parameters. Here we have, so this is the case when phi is non-zero. If phi prime is non-zero, then we have this decay rate when beta is equal to one, this estimate. So these were results on the real line. So these were results when we have integral over real line, but we have a bit more results when we integrate over bounded set, because if integrate over the whole line, we have to deal with integrability. Here we don't, this bounded interval. So interval is finite, and we have this second type under Corput lemma. So we assume phi of k's derivative is non-zero. Then again, we have, if alpha is between 0 and 2, beta is large enough, then we get a constant, we get a decay rate with like in the classical under Corput lemma, but there is a logarithmic loss. If beta, but independent of beta, if beta is between, is less than alpha plus one, then we get this additional loss, which additional term, which may depend on beta. And if alpha is equal to beta, then we have an improvement. So if alpha is equal to beta, then we look at this result for general alpha beta, we have logarithmic loss here. But if alpha is equal to beta, then we can remove this logarithmic loss, and we just get lambda to the power minus one over k. This is the result when k is one and derivative monotonic, but if it's C2, then we can we have the same result. So so I think it's almost finished. So this is the second type of Riemann-Lebesgue lemma. So I recall here Riemann-Lebesgue lemma tells that f is integrable, then Fourier transform goes to zero for large values of the Fourier parameter. Van der Corput lemma tells us that if f is in C1, that actually we can say that it decays like 1 over k. And here the second type of, so now we have this extension, I to the power alpha. Analog of Riemann-Lebesgue lemma is that it goes to 0, but analog of Van der Corput lemma is that f is in C1, then we get this decay rate, which depends on k. Again, for large beta, it doesn't depend on beta, but for small beta, it depends on beta. So, okay, so I'm now finished. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there any question?
Can I ask a question?
Go ahead, please.
Yeah, my name is Ravshan Ashur. You see, Michael, in case of van der Corput integrals, you have not only estimates, but also asymptotic behavior. How about in this case with Mittag-Leffler functions? Can you get some asymptotic behavior also?
So in some cases, this is a good question. So this is, you see, in general, we don't cover the whole, we don't cover all ranges of parameters, but for some parameters like here, because when for some values of parameters, indeed, we know asymptotics of Mittag-Leffler functions, and here I put estimates, but in fact, one can get some asymptotics for these cases. So for some ranges of parameters, one can get some asymptotics, but we haven't so this is already quite a lot of ranges of parameters, a lot of estimates. So we were concentrating on the estimates first, but in these cases, I think in these cases, if you know asymptotic behavior of Mittag-Leffler functions, then you can get asymptotics for these integrals.
Yeah. But
this is, of course, if there is motivation for such things, but it's, I think it's possible.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
May I ask something?
Yes.
Okay. So, well, you mentioned two properties of Mittag-Leffler, like this separation of real and imaginary part, like Euler type thing, and the estimate. Are there any other properties of Mittag-Leffler that you use in the proofs, which play a role?
So the first, Mittag-Leffler first lemma, basically we use these properties plus some splitting of integrals, which plus some technical things like you may split the integral and so on. Especially in the second van der Corput lemma, we use these facts plus some induction argument and some ways of splitting the integral into different parts and estimating different parts. But basically, these are general arguments which have nothing to do with Mittag-Leffler.
So for Mittag-Leffler, just these two properties.
Yes, just, in some case we use also this kind of property integration by parts property here.
Derivative. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yes, and that's why we cannot. So we cover the cases between 1 and 2, alpha between 0 and 1 and 0 and 2. We don't cover other alphas because we don't have these properties for Mittag-Leffler functions. So once we have good properties of these functions, then we can estimate the integrals.
But these properties, they seem to hold for, not they don't hold for all alpha? Which property fails?
Well, this property is okay, but for example, in this kind of estimate.
The estimate, okay. Uh-huh.
Again, Euler formula in integration by parts called for all alpha, but if you want to have this kind of estimate, we have this, and then also the other estimate which I showed here. This kind of estimate, so they require alpha to be between 0 and 2. But as I say, we can put different extensions of exponential function, and once we have good properties of those special functions, then we can estimate such integrals.
And for Mittag-Leffler, you know, there is a huge paper by Sedletsky where he studied the zeros and all kinds of stuff, like 160 pages, two parts.
Yes, there is also a book of Kilbas. Mittag-Leffler functions. Ragozin and so on. There is a book which gives a lot of a lot of analysis, but it's not sometimes it's not really they don't get estimates, but they don't write estimates which we need. But thank you for pointing that out.
Yeah, I think Sedlecki, he used the estimates in different intervals to get the asymptotics and zeros, stuff like that, but you might have to check. Okay.
I know the book of, as I said, the book, but I, the paper I will.
That's a different thing. It's not, yes. Not directly related.
I saw that. So I maybe if you say there could be, but as far as I remember that paper, I think because we looked at some literature, and these are the estimates which we
okay.
They lead to estimates for oscillatory integrals.
Ah, and another very technical, maybe stupid question. And many times you have this property derivative in the original van der Corput, like derivative bigger than one. So one is just some positive number, so up to scale it, right? So you mean it's just non-zero?
Yes, one
has no meaning. One has no special meaning.
Yes, one has no special meaning except for if it is bigger than one, then we get. Well, there are things like what the constants depend on. So. Mm-hmm. If you say bigger than one, then the constant is uniform, doesn't depend on phi.
So one has a meaning. Okay.
It has a meaning of that the constant is uniform, is bigger than one. So in some results we write explicitly. When in some results we write explicitly that what the constant depends on, because it's another important question for oscillatory integrals. If in the induction argument, actually, when you split the integral, like in the proof of van der Corput lemma, then you get a constant which is less than one, and then you have to use a rescaled version. So then you have, you see how the constant depends on this. So it is, one has a meaning. So one is important in some sense for to get uniform estimates in some cases.
Thank you.
I have one question, Professor Ruzhansky. It's more about in the proof of charness. The proof is estimating from below directly, or did you test with some specific phase functions, or the proof is directly estimating from below?
Yes, the proof is directly estimating from below, because as Professor Shurov asks about asymptotic expansion, so this is related. Once we, in these cases, we actually know asymptotic expansions, and since we know asymptotic expansion, we look at the first term, and then this gives estimate from below.
Okay, thank you.
But if you're not interested in estimate,
the question, yeah, go ahead, please. Okay, no. Okay, I think that it is time to stop here. What do you think, Mikhail? Huh?